Okay, hello everyone. We are going to start the seminar today. Today we will have a seminar about the J-PASS survey that will be given by Rosa González Delgado here from the IAA-CSIC. Most of you, or at least all the people in the room, knows Rosa, but I will introduce her. So Rosa made a PhD at the Instituto de Física de Canarias in between 1990 and 1995. Then she made a postdoc at the Space Telescope Science Institute in Baltimore. And since 1998, she has been working at IAA. She is currently professor de investigación here at IAA, and she's specialized in the galaxy evolution, star populations, star formation, and nuclear activity in galaxies. She has supervised 7 PhDs, and other 2 are currently in progress. If I'm not wrong. She has published more than 180 papers in high impact journals with many other contributions to conferences, etc. She has been member of a number of scientific evaluation committees, such as the legacy orbit of the Observatorio de Calalambre, the Hubble Space Telescope, the ESO OPC, Calar Alto, etc. She is currently the director of the Extragalactic Astronomy Department here at IAA. So, Rosa, now the floor is to you.
Thank you for the presentation. Okay, well, I had to take this opportunity to thank the IAA for supporting my research. Last December was 25 years ago that I arrived as a postdoc here, so I'm very I want to say thank you to all of you, because it was a pleasure to work at the Institute. So now I'm going to present the J-PASS survey. The main driver of this talk is to show you the potential of J-PASS to trace the role of star formation and environment in galaxy evolution. So, and this work has been done, of course, with all the J-PASS collaboration. Mariano is present here, so which is the main person in the collaboration, because thanks to him, it is possible to do this project. But of course, they have a lot of, I have a lot of support from all the collaboration, in particular to the CESCA and the UPA that was the responsible of the data redaction and all the management of the survey. So let's start with a brief introduction. So it is well known that the galaxy population show a bimodal distribution. Most of the galaxies were distributed in the so-called blue cloud and in the red sequence. At the resid in the nearby universe, the blue cloud, it is usually populated by blue galaxy, star-forming galaxy, but the red sequence is more populated by the all stellar population galaxy that are also meta-rich. In between, it is the so-called Green Valley, where it is mainly populated by transition galaxy that probably it is evolving from the blue cloud to the red sequence. This bimodal distribution also persists not only at low resid, but also at higher resid. We can also show the bimodal distribution in the main sequence plane, which is the correlation between the star formation rate in the galaxy and the stellar mass. So this line, it is the main sequence, and you see that the most of the galaxies here are galaxies that belong to the blue cloud. And they are very still actively forming a star. Below the main sequence, it is the galaxy that has already quenched the star formation. They are not a star formation, or it is below in a very low level. But the key point is how to know how the galaxy can evolve from the main sequence to the quiescent phase. Usually, we call this process quenching because the process to go to the rest sequence has to be very rapid, has to be very rapid, because in other case, we couldn't explain the density number of red galaxy that it is at the rest zero, taking in consideration the number density that it is in the green valley, which is the transition of galaxy at rest one. So that means that this process has to be very quick, and that's why we call quenching process. The quenching process could be internal or external. Most of the internal process, it is associated to the galaxy mass, and that's why normally we call mass quenching to the internal process. Of course, they not really have to be associated with the stellar mass, could be caused by the stellar mass of the galaxy, but other process, for example, the black hole that could be the center of the galaxy could be responsible of the quenching, internal quenching process. Yes, that's in fact the AGM feedback, it is connecting with the mass quenching, because you know that there is a correlation between the mass of the black hole and also the velocity dispersion of the galaxy, that it is reflecting the galaxy mass of the galaxy. And this correlation, what they indicated is that the same way that the galaxy is growing in mass also is growing the central part and feeding the black hole. And that's why AGN could be connected with the internal process that producing the quenching and the stellar mass of the galaxy. It is known that in fact the radiation from the, for example, from the AGNs can hit the surrounding gas, and in that case, they stop can stop the star formation in the galaxy. However, other theory consider that the key point for the formation of the black hole, for example, is not really linked to the growth of the mass, but instead is connected with the stellar mass density that they have the galaxy, because there is the galaxy that start first in their star formation and has also the larger black hole is those that at the given mass they have higher stellar mass surface density. On the other hand, the quenching could be connected with the external process as a sample of the environment. It is well known from a long time ago that there is a connection between the fraction of red galaxy and also the fraction of early type galaxy, elliptical and spheroidal, with the density of galaxy, density number of galaxy. So that means that in cluster, this fraction of red galaxy increase with the density. Also, there is a lot of, however, the process that it is associated with the different process that it is associated with the environment could be certainly quench the star formation, for example, the ram pressure, where you expected that the medium is acting to shut down the star formation in the outer part of the galaxy, and the quench in the galaxy could be producing from outside to inside the galaxy. But there is other process, for example, the merging, where the gas could be filling to the central part of the galaxy, first produce an starburst, and later they produce the quench of the star formation. So that means that there is a lot of diversity of process and different situation where they can predominate one or another process. In fact, it is now more often talking about the mass environmental quenching because the two processes could be connected and the one be more predominant than the other, depending, for example, the mass of the depending on the mass of the galaxy, and also depending on the situation of the different pathway that the galaxy could be following to be member of a cluster. For example, we can some galaxy could be first falling into the group, and there they can quench, and this D group could be accreting and form part of the cluster. But a galaxy could by independently be accreting to the cluster, and there could be quench. So that means that there is a lot of diversity and process through which the star formation could be quenched in the also in a in a in a cluster or in a group. So far, the galaxy survey has been very successful to study the role of the environment in galaxy evolution. Most of the survey it is done by photometry, covering in some case very large sky area. But they have done mainly with a few broadband, for example, the Sloan system, and also a few narrowband filter. So, and they put some limitation in the kind of study that we can do. For example, if we use only a few narrowband filter, we can select only galaxy that at a given resi. If we want to study, for example, the emission from H alpha or other emission line. So that means that have a lot of limitation. In contrast, the spectroscopy survey, where we don't have this, for example, this limitation where we can observe the for example, the optical range and have all the most of the emission line in the range that we are observing. But the main problem is that usually have a very small sky area. So that means that the, in general, these two different approach to do the observation or to study the effect of the environment in galaxy evolution has several limitations. But in particular, we need to do this kind of analysis to know very the resi to identify the galaxy that belong to the group or they belong to the cluster. Also, we need in general spectroscopic information because we want to characterize the galaxy population. We want to segregate the sample between the red galaxy, blue galaxy, star forming AGNs, for example. Also, we want to distinguish between, for example, the galaxies that have star forming, or galaxies that have an AGN. So that means that in general, even has been very successful. Most of these kind of studies started with the broadband photometry, for example, and later they need to go to do a spectroscopy. And the problem is that with the spectroscopy, the elimination of the sample is quite important. I mean, because we cannot get a spectra for many gaps. To overcome to this problem is why, in some way, JPass work. So JPass is a survey of more than 5,000 square degrees in the northern sky. This is the expected footprint. The green area, it is the 5,000 square degree, and we expect it to extend it to larger area in the future. It is done by the 2.5 meter telescope in the Observatorio de Javalambre. And we have the photometry system that it is formed by 56 narrowband filter with a full we have maximum of 145 astron. And the good thing is that they are covering most of the optical spectral range and in a continuum way. So that means that we can cover the optical range and to have equivalent to a spectroscopy of low resolution, of the resolution around 60. Also, we have a camera, which is the GPCAM, that has 14 CCD, and the field of view, it is almost 4 square degrees. And you can see here, this is an image taken by the first line of the instrument. We can cover to map to the galaxy M31 with only one pointing. So it is incredible, very wide field of view. The project is almost starting. We have very good news from yesterday from Tony. So that we are almost ready to start. But before we did a study with the Pathfinder camera, which is only one CCD, and we decided to take the AGES film, which is this string, and we take for pointing to cover 1 square degree. This survey we call mini JPath because we have done with the same photometry system, and they allow to test or to check most of the project that we can do with JPass, and to check out also our code and see which is the result that we can expect. The survey was the public release was done in December 19. We have the publication of this data release. The data are free for everyone that want to access, and they are calibrated. So two important results of the survey is this related with the spectroscopy accuracy, and the other it is with the completeness of the sample. Thus, the plot of the precision of the resi as a function of the magnitude of the object. And we see that for most of the object, we can get a accuracy which is 0.0%, which is the expected value at the when was preparing the survey. Also, the other important result related with the completeness is that all the standing objects with magnitude 22.75, the survey is complete, and for point source is 23.6. So that means that they are not so deep as expected for big, survey done with a big telescope. But it is a very this survey for this kind of observation. This is the more important summary that I hope that you take from here, from this talk, is that the power of JPass for galaxy evolution study is related with this point from my point of view, which is the photometry system, the 56 narrowband filter, because they can provide a low spectral resolution for millions of galaxies, and they allow to identify and characterize the blue and the red galaxy population. So later, what I'm going to do is to show evidence in base of the mini JPass data about this statement that I say here. The second one is that the fluid have maximum of the filter. They are allowed to identify emission line galaxy up to resic one at least through the identification of H alpha, H beta, oxygen 3, and oxygen 2. The third one is related with the accuracy of the photo C that allow to identify and map the galaxy member of group and cluster up to resic one, and to produce a complete mass density group and cluster catalog. The fourth point, it is related with the sky area larger than 5,000 square degree that allow to that will this is for the future, of course, because so far we have only one square degree, but we expect that we will be able to statistically isolate the effect of the environment, the stellar mass, the morphology on the galaxy property. And the fifth one that could not prove properly with the mini J-bus because we don't have too many objects, but we are working on it, is that the thanks to the photometric system and also to the spatial scale of the camera, we can resolve the spatially the property of the nearby galaxy and to do a few light study at least to resin around 0.1. Okay, let's go to the first one, which is that the photometric resin allow to identify and characterize the galaxy population. This is one example, several examples of the object that we are observing in mini J-bus. There are blue galaxy, red galaxy, and the color point, it is the what we call the G spectra, which is the spectral energy distribution of this galaxy taken by the photometric system of J-bus. And in black, we are providing the spectral fit of this data. For that, we have built several stellar population model to retrieve the property of the galaxy. And in that case, this is the result from Bayesian, which is a Bayesian parametric code. And we assume a delay tau model for the stellar population. Okay, the important thing, you can, this is a different sample taking a different resin and also covering a magnitude from 19 to 22.4, which is almost all the range of the galaxy that we are able to analyze. In total, in mini J-bus, we have around 10,000 galaxy, so in one square degree. And the first conclusion that we derive is that the determination of the stellar population property of the galaxy has a precision, which is quite similar to the precision that we can get with the normally with the spectroscopy data of intermediate resolution and also with the signal to noise around 10. So that means that in some way we are quite similar to spectroscopy survey. So after the identification and characterization of this galaxy population, we can make a study, a different slide of resi to build the color mass diagram, the blue cloud, the red sequence, and see how it evolved with the resi and to map which is the fraction of red and blue galaxy in the and how they evolve with the resin. Also, if you look at that, and this is the mass over the resin of the sample, and you see here that we can build a sample with mass over 10 to the 10 solar masses, a resin 0.8. Which is will be quite good and very good statistically talking about. And also with a small sample of galaxy of mini J-bus in the range of 0.1, we make the fossil record of the stellar population. We apply this and we can get the Cosmic evolution of the star formation rate in a function of Resi. That's the black point that we estimated, and the other is this data derived by other survey. So that means that with the mini J path, we were able to follow the evolution of the Cosmic star formation rate up to Resi almost three. So that's a sample of the thing of the analysis that we can do with this data. The second point was related with the full we have maximum of the system, photometric system, that they allow to estimate and identify emission line object. That's one example of the galaxy in mini JPL. You see here clearly the oxygen 3. Also H alpha nitrogen 2 and oxygen 2 9. So Ginés in Martinez Solaeche in his PhD, they develop a methodology which is related with machine learning, in particular artificial neural network. And with this method, we are able to not only to identify emission line galaxy, but also to measure the equivalent width of the H alpha nitrogen 2 and segregate the two lines, which is quite important because usually for the full we have maximum of the filter, the two lines will be the same in the same filter. And also oxygen 3 and H beta. So in that way, we can build the BPT diagram, which is the diagram between the oxygen 3 over H beta with respect to nitrogen 2 over H alpha. And in that way, we can distinguish between the star forming galaxy, which is here in this arm, or from AGN, that usually Cypher galaxy are here, or Liner, which is here. So that means that we have proved that, in fact, at least for resis 0.35, because this is this method, it is applied only at this resi, but we expect it to extend it to resi 1 using another emission line. We can not only identify the emission line object, but also to distinguish between the different mechanisms that produce the emission line, star forming or an AGNs. That's one example when we apply to the mini JPass galaxy, and also when we combine it with the fitting of the continuum, we can get the property of the stellar population and see which is the correlation between the emission line property of the galaxy and also the stellar population property. As expected, the galaxy which is in the res sequence, they have very low equivalent width of H alpha, which is not produced by the star massy star, but in contrast, it is produced by an AGS. Probably it is associated to a Liner or a Cypher line. And also we can, this is the BPT diagram from MiniJ bus to distinguish between the cipher and the star forming, and also some liners. And we can get also which is the density of emission line galaxy, star forming, cipher, or quiescence or quench galaxy, and compare. And how it is the evolution of this quantity with the resi. The third point that I was mentioned is that the accuracy of the photo C, they allow to map group and cluster up to resi 1. This is one example. Matteo Maturi, it is leading this part of the project. We are using the Amico code and the response of the Amico code are several slides. They can get the density map of galaxy and to identify the group or cluster they are present in mini JPass. So the good, this is two examples. This is a very close group, RSI 0.08. This is a cluster that has been studied by Julio Rodriguez Martin. The good thing is that we can sampling the group also with very low mass, which is around 10 to the 13 solar masses. So that means that thanks to the accuracy of the photo C, we can get the galaxy member in group and cluster, and to get a possible catalog of this object. Well, this is also one example when we combine the result from this catalog with the stellar population analysis that we are doing. We are studying the big cluster in many JPass, that after all it is a normal cluster, but RSI 0.1929. And this is the distribution of the galaxy population in the cluster, with the red point indicate the red galaxy, the identification of the red galaxy. The blue one, it is the blue galaxy, and also the emission line object, which is the white point. With this identification, we can get which is the fraction of red galaxy and blue galaxy, and how they change with the radial distance. So here we found that most of the red galaxy it is concentrated in the inner part of the cluster. Also, because we have other property at the star formation rate and the specific star formation rate for this galaxy, we can get how it changes this one as a function of the virial radial distance, and we see that most of the red galaxy, they are equally distributed with the distance with similar specific star formation rate, which is quite low, as indicating that it is quench, but it is expected. And here, the blue galaxy, the specific star formation rate decreased to the inner part of the cluster. So that means that it is compatible with a scenario where the quenching go to the cluster is producing from the outer part of the cluster to the inner one part. But in total, with AMICO, we have identified 80 groups, and we can put one of the properties that is given by AMICO, it is the probability association. And with this probability, we can distinguish between the galaxy member that belong to the cluster and the galaxy or cluster or group, and the galaxy that they are not part of this density environment, and we associate it with what we call the film, which is normally used. In total, as I mentioned, it is 80 groups. This is the distribution in the mini J path, where the circle are indicated the brighter galaxy in each group. That's several examples of the G spectra that we can get for the brighter galaxy, the second brighter galaxy, or any other galaxy. Covering, this is three examples of different resid at one cluster and two intermediate group. Okay, so we analyze the G spectra and we get the stellar population property of this galaxy. We can build the color and mass diagram for the galaxy that belong to the field and galaxy that belong to the group. We can distinguish also between the red sequence, the blue cloud, but also there is a bunch of galaxy that are in a transition phase that we identify because we have the color, which is blue, But the specific star formation rate, it is below 0.1 per gigajia, which is more or less the limit where one galaxy we can be considered as star forming, or galaxy where it is in a sub-down phase of the star formation. This is also visible, this galaxy, in the plane of the specific star formation rate with respect to the mass, which is another way to express the main sequence of the star formation. And we can derive the fraction or red galaxy that it is in groups, and the galaxy that it is in the field. We see here that for a given mass, always the fraction of red galaxy in group are higher than the galaxy that it is in the field. Another way to see this result is, instead of talking about red and blue galaxy, we can talk about quiescent galaxy, quenching galaxy. If instead of the color, we use the specific star formation rate to distinguish between star forming and quenching galaxy. That's the result also at the given mass. The fraction of quenching galaxy increase with the stellar mass, but also it is always higher in group with respect to the field. Another example will be to consider or to calculate which is the difference between the fraction, because quenching galaxy, it is expected in the field, it is in the group, although we are higher in the group. But the excess of quenching, the quenching fraction excess, it is the, let's say, the difference between the fraction of quenching galaxy in group with respect to the field, but normalized to the total fraction of galaxy. In that case, we see that also increase with the stellar mass. Another aspect that only this is, as you can imagine, this is only done with one square degree, 80 group, and this number have a lot of uncertainty. And in particular, for example, if we want to estimate which is the efficiency of group for quenching the star formation. And for that, what we did is compare which is the quenching fraction SF with respect in the small the smaller group with respect to the with the higher cluster or the mass, the most massive cluster that we have. Clearly, the efficiency is looked to depends with the mass halo of the group and the cluster. But this is the kind of thing that we can estimate properly with the JPASC, but not here with mini JPASC because we are dealing with a very small number of group. And finally, in this respect, also we can estimate it, which is the evolution of the galaxy quenching rate, where we can get different value up to recipe 0.8, which is the larger recipe that we have for we had detected groups in mini JPASC, but you look at this, this rate depend on the abundant excess of the transition galaxy, and the number of transition galaxy that we have in mini JPASC is very small because the fraction of this galaxy is in general small. So that means that we need a larger area to properly obtaining this quantity and make that this error bar will be significantly smaller, and they allow properly to distinguish between the different model of the evolution for the quenching rate. So, and this is the kind of thing that we're expecting to do with the large survey. So notice that most of the that all the result that has already presented here, it is based on the integrated property of galaxies. With this analysis, we're expecting that in fact with JPass we'll be getting around 90 million of galaxies with magnitude less than 22.75. So that means that it's a lot of galaxies where the error bar and the constraint that we can put to this quantity will be significantly smaller than what we have done. Also, this is a factor 20 larger than the Sloan spectroscopy survey. And it is about a factor 3 larger than the number of galaxies that will be observed by this. And in addition, we are expecting, according with mini JPass, we are expecting more than 500,000 of group and cluster. So this is a lot of information for which we can constrain a lot of problems related with the role of the environment in galaxy evolution. To finish, let me do mention the third point, which is related with the IFULI study. In mini JPass, the number of galaxies are resting less than 0.1, it is quite small, but we were lucky because one of the galaxies of mini JPass were observed by manga. So that means that at least the allow to test it, the capability of JPass to make IFULI study. This is the sample, this is the in green, it is the spectral manga corresponding to the central 0.1 effective radio or half-life radio. And the black pole, it is the JPass data. So first, we were very happy to see that the extraction of the similar area, our G spectra is really very good in agreement with the manga data. Notice that this circle is more or less the area that has been observed by manga. However, with JPass, we can go to larger extension. When we compute, we fit the spectra with a starlight and we fit the point G spectra with the basic arm, and we derive the ages. We are also very happy to see that the manga result and the spectroscopy result and the photometric result, it is equivalent, we got a similar value, but the advantage is that with manga only we can get these 2 points, but with JPass we can go to effective radio. So we can map the galaxy to the outer part. Also, this is very important because thanks to the field of view of the camera, in only one point, we can map all the galaxies that belong to the nearby cluster, the Abel cluster. This is the distribution of the Abel cluster in the footprint of JPass over 20 degrees in the declination. We have plenty of Abel cluster to be done this kind of analysis. And also the other point is that also we can map galaxy as big as 7331, which is a very nearby galaxy that has a size of 10 Armini, for four Armini, I think. So it is quite big galaxy. This kind of galaxy cannot be done with any other IFU instrument so far. So that means that we had the opportunity to make a study and mapping all the galaxy that belong to the nearby cluster, but also the nearby galaxy as large as this one. In addition, that by chance in this footprint, there is a lot of galaxy that has a size which is similar to the galaxy that will be sampling by the WIF aperture survey, but also by the Khalifa as we did, and also by the manga survey. So that means that this is the future. And also, as I mentioned, we can mapping the property of the galaxy up to several effective radii. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosa, for this very nice seminar on JPass. Now the session is open for questions, both here in the room and in Zoom. So please raise your hands.
Okay, just a question. You make an analysis of several properties of galaxies as a function of belonging to a cluster or a group or to the field. Why, instead of doing so, you can do analysis as a function of the local density? Because the at the beginning, the expression relations that we have are really going as a function of local density, not belonging to any other country.
Mm.
It's similar, but it's not exactly the same.
No, as you say, it is not the same. In fact, in this work that we did for to compare the group and the galaxy that belong to the group with respect to the field, we also to take into account the sigma phi parameter, which is the measure, which is the distance, or it is related with the distance of the field closer galaxy. In particular, for example, for the fraction of the red and blue galaxy, we obtaining a similar result. But in principle, the potential of JPass to distinguish between groups and field galaxies, it is very important. Because normally in other survey cannot be distinguished, in particular the group or low mass cannot be identified. We thought that it was very more important for JPass to make the analysis in this way. But in fact, this is another of the kind of analysis. I don't have here the plot, but I can show you later, where we can also derive as a function of the sigma phi parameter or the density or any other density parameter to do this kind of analysis.
Okay, more questions?
Sorry, I am no expert in this field, but something that attracted my attention was the quenching for the star formation. Could you say more about this? Which is the meaning of this? You expect to find the star formation only in the center? And also, could you explain the mechanism to produce this effect?
The mechanism, it is a lot of different mechanisms. As I mentioned in the introduction, could be internal mechanism, which is associated to the proper internal property of the galaxy. So in general, because usually quenching is related with the all stellar population and massive galaxy, it was we thought that maybe was connecting with the stellar mass of the galaxy, but in fact it is only some skew for say that, because in reality it is more connecting with internal process that occur in the galaxy. For example, the presence of a black hole or an AGNs, because the AGNs can hit in the gas which is surrounding the galaxy, and if the gas is hitting, cannot be for a new star, and they stop the star formation. This is, for example, one mechanism that could be related with the quenching process. Other, which is related with environments, for example, with the ram pressure stripping that can stripping the gas, and in that case, the cause the subdown of the star formation. And there is a lot of different mechanisms that could be in different kind of galaxy, in different environment, and also in different epoch of the galaxy. And that's why the problem is complicated. It's not so simple as in principle we could expect. Is enough for your?
I am trying to associate this problem with star formation because also the problem to quench the ionized gas in ultra-compact two regions. And some people think about the radiation pressure that I already mentioned to explain the quenching.
Yes,
I do.
It's similar, but in a different scale. So let's say if you hit the gas or you screen the gas, you cannot continue forming a star. That's the main reason. So it is similar to the smaller in a star region or class. Star class.
Thank you very much, Rosa, for such a up-to-date talk on the results in GFS. It's an enormous way. And I think it's very timely to show how things are being prepared and are ready to start the JPAS. So could you please remind the audience what the time scale is for the connection to itself?
Well, we are expecting to start the scientific operation or JPAS quite soon. And when I say quite soon, I don't know exactly if it's the scale of several weeks or a month or whatever. We expect it quite soon. Also, the expected rate of the survey will be about 1,000 square degrees. Per years, something less probably in reality, but I mean in principle the expectation could be done in this way. So that means in 5 years we can get the 5,000 square degree, which is the first tiers of the observation. Later we can go to the second tier, which is about 8,000 square degree. So, but I mean, the scale could be from less, so more than 5 years to 10 years of the survey, I will say. After that, probably we are full of data to be understanding and analyzed.
Hey, Rosa, first, congratulations for your 25th anniversary at the IAA.
Thank you.
Was always good to hear. I have a question. I mean, this talk has shown how the Pathfinder and the Pathfinder results gives really a very good hint on the things that will be done in the future. And in that sense, it's very promising, and these are very good news that I don't know whether it will be weeks or months, but I mean, the normal observing is already starting. I think these are very good news. Let me ask you just a very simple question about the tools that you have developed for data analysis, and really, I mean, how near are you from those tools that you will need for the whole project?
So far we have done tools to fit in the G spectra and to get the stellar population property, also the tool based on the artificial neural network to estimate identify emission line galaxy. The problem related with this methodology is that it can be applied only to resi 0.35, which is the maximum resi where H alpha could be inside the JPAS observation. But one of the plan is to extend this methodology to identify star forming galaxy using only oxygen 3 H beta and oxygen 2 line. So that's something that can be done in relatively easy way. We have done, I didn't, but Julio is doing a pipeline to do to the analysis, the, I feel like a study. So it is ready. I mean, version zero is ready. So we are, he is right now doing the analysis of a few galaxies that can be resolved in many JPAS. The problem is that the galaxies are relatively small because are RESI 0.0807, so very close to the maximum RESI that we expected to analyze with JPAS. But at least this tool, it is also ready. Now we have an other problem, which is to prepare new tools that allow to fit all 90 million of galaxies. So also Ginés and Luis also too is working in this kind of analysis, putting together other technique that personally I don't I don't understand, which is also based in machine learning. Maybe he can say something more about the emulator and speculator or many things to be able to speed up the fit. This is so that means that the inter we are the basic tools to do the analysis that we have done. Also thanks to the Amico and Matteo Maturi, because the is the person that it is running the Amico and providing the group catalog. So this is one part that in my group cannot be done by ourselves, but the rest of the tool, basic tool are ready, but we need to continue preparing tool to allow to analyze all the million of galaxies that will be available in JPAS.
Okay. There are no more questions. No questions in Zoom, so it's time to finish. So now let's thank Rosa again. And remember, next week we will have two seminars on Tuesday and on Thursday. So thank you very much.